Hey guys, and welcome back to Concordia Jedi, and welcome to Lightsaber History.
This is the weapon of a Jedi Knight.
Today, we're discussing the lightsaber wielded by Count Dooku. Count Dooku was born in 102 BBY on the planet Sereno to Count Gora and Countess Anya. At a very young age, Dooku's force sensitivity began to manifest, frightening his parents, especially his father, who saw force users as freaks. Countess Anya contacted the Jedi Order, telling them to take Dooku away. But before the Jedi even arrived, Count Gora abandoned the infant Dooku on the edge of the forest beyond the palace walls. Luckily, a seeker rescued Dooku before he froze to death or could be eaten by the dangerous wildlife and brought him to the Jedi Temple on Coruscant, where he was integrated into a clan of younglings along with a young pupil named Sifo Dyas, under the tutelage and direction of Master Terra Sanube. Dooku strove to excel, working to become the greatest of his fellow students, but always trying to stay in the boundaries and adhere to the rules set by his teachers. Because of this, he would often distance himself from the other students rather than try to befriend them, with the exception of Sifo Dyas. In 90 BBY, at the age of 12, Dooku would accompany Grandmaster Yoda and Master Sanube to Sereno, where a galactic festival was being held. Seeing a girl he recognized as his sister Jenza, Dooku would run off with her, only to be found later by Sifo Dyas, covered in rubble after an earthquake. The Jedi Masters lifted the rubble and freed the two siblings, only for Count Gora to furiously confront Yoda, telling him that he never wished to see his son again. Dooku would learn the truth about how his father abandoned him, and though his ties to his father were cut, he would secretly keep in contact with his sister. During the next few years, Dooku and Sifo Dyas would often break many rules by sneaking into the Jedi archives to learn more about the darker aspects of the Force and what it offered. In 86 BBY, after completing his initiate trials, Dooku would enter the Padawan tournament, hoping to be selected as an apprentice by Master Lene Costana due to her mission of hunting down dark side relics. However, after defeating Sifo Dyas blindfolded and with one hand behind his back, Dooku would be selected not by Master Costana, who would instead decide to train Sifo Dyas, but by Master Yoda. Yoda and Dooku would go on many missions together, including a mission to Kashyyyk, where Dooku would witness Yoda defeat a monstrous Tyrantitech. Dooku held great respect for his master's strength, but that respect would come to fade in the coming years. In 85 BBY, Sifo Dyas received a force vision of a large solar storm hitting the planet Protobranch. Dooku, Sifo Dyas, and Master Costana would inform the council of this vision, and suggested that they warn the planet of the impending danger. Yoda, however, denied this order, as force visions were not absolute, and that the future was always in motion. Going behind the council's back, Dooku, Sifo Dyas, and Costana would inform the senator of Protobranch, Senator Tevedi, of the coming storm. However, Tevedi was more concerned about the resources of the planet than its inhabitants, something that unnerved Dooku. Yoda, though reluctant, would accompany the three Jedi to Protobranch to warn them. Ultimately, however, the vision came true as a solar storm wiped out much of the population, with the Jedi just barely surviving. Dooku was deeply disturbed by this event, and it would severely shake his trust in both the Republic for their primary concern being the planet's resources over the people, and the Jedi Council, whom he saw as partially responsible for the deaths caused by the storm. Years would go by and Dooku would pass his trials and eventually would attain the rank of Jedi Master, even gaining a seat on the Jedi High Council. During this time, he would set aside his original Jedi weapon and construct a new lightsaber with an elegant design and a curved hilt. In 86 BBY, Dooku would take 12-year-old Qui-Gon Jinn as his Padawan. Dooku saw much potential in the young boy, as he deduced that Qui-Gon was, like most new Padawans, afraid. Not of Dooku, but fearful of not becoming a Jedi, afraid of failure. Dooku saw this as wise, as most Padawans would deny their fear rather than recognizing it. Dooku would teach Qui-Gon much of the Jedi and their ways, giving him a tour of the temple, and over the next several years, the two of them would be sent on many missions together, with many of Dooku's ideals and beliefs rubbing off on Qui-Gon. Eventually, Qui-Gon would become a Jedi Master himself and take on an apprentice of his own, Obi-Wan Kenobi, whom he spoke very highly of to Dooku. Over time, however, Dooku would grow more and more disillusioned with the Jedi Order, and in 42 BBY, he would leave the Order entirely, becoming the 20th to do so. Saying goodbye to his old master and his friend Sifo-Dyas, he promised they would see each other again. He would return to Sereno, claiming his birthright as Count of Sereno, and all but disappeared from the public eye. At some point in time, Dooku would be approached on Sereno by Darth Sidious, who sought the former Jedi to lead his growing separatist movement. Utilizing Dooku's inner desire for both power and the destruction of the corrupt Republic, Dooku would agree to join Sidious, becoming his apprentice and being granted the new name of Darth Tyrannus. Soon, Dooku would help his new master to set the foundation of what would become one of the most devastating wars in galactic history, the Clone Wars. Dooku's biggest priority was to oversee the creation of a clone army intended for use by the Republic. Hoping to give this project legitimacy, Dooku contacted his old friend Sifo-Dyas, who himself was growing disillusioned with the Republic's political climate, and Sifo-Dyas agreed to commission the Kaminoans to create a clone army for the Republic. Dooku, however, needed to be sure that Sifo-Dyas would remain silent on this matter and hired Lom Pike of the Pike Syndicate to murder Sifo-Dyas by shooting his shuttle down during a mission. His body was then delivered to Dooku. It is unknown what happened to it. Dooku would go on to recruit the bounty hunter Jango Fett to be a genetic template for the clone army. The clones would be outfitted with biochips in their brains that could be used to eventually trigger a protocol that would spell the doom of the Jedi Order. Dooku would travel to many systems disillusioned with the Republic and would recruit them to the Separatist movement. Soon, the Confederacy of Independent Systems was established. During this time, Dooku would also take on a new student to be trained as his personal assassin, Asajj Ventress. In 22 BBY, Dooku and the Confederacy had begun production of new armies of battle droids. Not only this, Dooku hired Jango Fett to assassinate Senator Padme Amidala on several occasions at the request of Newt Gunray, in exchange for him joining their cause. During this time, Obi-Wan Kenobi and Anakin Skywalker would be assigned to protect Padme. The two would end up foiling another assassination attempt on Padme, and the Council would assign Anakin to escort Padme to Naboo to keep her safe while Obi-Wan would be assigned with tracking down the assassin. Obi-Wan was led to the planet Kamino, where he would learn of the clone army and inform the Council. He would also discover Jango Fett and attempt to apprehend him, fighting him on the flight deck and tracking him to Geonosis, where he would discover the construction of thousands of battle droids. Unfortunately, Obi-Wan would be captured and held prisoner. Upon learning of this, Dooku would visit the restrained Obi-Wan, telling him that the Republic was under the control of Darth Sidious. He would try to convince Obi-Wan to join him, but Obi-Wan, disgusted with what Dooku had become, would refuse. Obi-Wan would soon be scheduled for execution. Anakin and Padme would learn of Obi-Wan's capture and travel to Geonosis to free him. They would be captured, however, and they too would be scheduled for execution alongside Obi-Wan. The executions would not go as planned, as Mace Windu and over 200 other Jedi would invade the arena, now swarmed by battle droids, in an attempt to free the captive Jedi and Senator Amidala. During the ensuing chaos, Jango Fett would be killed by Mace Windu, and the hundreds of Jedi would be whittled down to merely a handful. Dooku would offer the Jedi the opportunity to surrender lest they be destroyed. Windu would rebuke this offer, and the Jedi would prepare for another onslaught, only for Yoda to arrive with a cavalry of clone troopers who would liberate the Jedi as Dooku would attempt to escape to a nearby hangar in his ship. Dooku would escape to his hangar only to be confronted by Obi-Wan and Anakin. Anakin would be quickly dispatched by Dooku, who would engage Obi-Wan in a fierce duel, taunting him and eventually overpowering Kenobi. Anakin would intervene before the final blow could be dealt, briefly overpowering the Sith Lord before soon being defeated himself, losing an arm in the process. Before Dooku could leave, however, he would be confronted by his old master, Yoda. The two were evenly matched in their abilities with the Force, but after a fierce duel, Dooku would be forced to retreat, causing a pillar to nearly crush Obi-Wan and Anakin. He would escape to his ship and flee the planet while Yoda would save the two injured warriors. Dooku would rendezvous with Darth Sidious and the two would revel in the beginning of the Clone Wars. Over the course of the Clone Wars, Dooku would faithfully serve Sidious, recruiting more systems to their cause and occasionally fighting off the Jedi attempting to capture him. In 19 BBY, Darth Sidious, under the guise of his alter ego, Chancellor Palpatine, would orchestrate an attack on Coruscant, where he would be captured by General Grievous. Obi-Wan and Anakin would be sent to rescue the Chancellor, but they would once again be confronted by Count Dooku. The two Jedi would engage in a final duel with the Sith Lord, who would incapacitate Obi-Wan, knocking him unconscious. Taunting Anakin, Dooku and the young Jedi would continue the battle until Anakin managed to sever the Sith Lord's hands, and, grabbing his lightsaber, Anakin held the Sith Lord at his mercy, both blades at his throat. To Dooku's horror, Palpatine would encourage Anakin to murder the helpless Count. Though reluctant at first, Anakin's thirst for revenge would overpower his judgment, and he would sever Dooku's head from his shoulders. Dooku would meet his end here, betrayed by his master, seeing in the end the true treachery of the Sith, and that his murder would eventually be the catalyst for Anakin's downfall. Little is known of Dooku's first lightsaber. Upon becoming a master, however, Dooku would construct his final lightsaber that he would carry with him the rest of his life. Dooku's lightsaber was a very unusual design for its time period. The weapon was very sleek with a slight curve on either end. The saber had a gold switch up at the top of the emitter, which could instantly extend or shorten the length of the blade for surprise attacks, and a red trigger-like switch at the bottom for activation. A distinct feature this lightsaber had was a single claw protruding from the emitter that added a sinister flair to the design of the weapon. Dooku's lightsaber was designed specifically for the purpose of lightsaber combat, and thus was designed to fit comfortably in the hand. Thus, the grips and grooves on this hilt were very low profile to provide a comfortable grip when in use. Another interesting element of this saber is that there is no knob or ring to clip the saber onto the user's belt. Rather, there are magnetic fasteners at the bottom of the hilt that fasten the lightsaber to a magnetic clip on Dooku's belt. This meant that the weapon could be easily drawn and fastened in an instant. Dooku built this weapon as a Jedi, so red was not its original color. In fact, the original color of this blade was blue. When he became a Sith Lord, however, Dooku bled his crystal, turning it a bright blood red. Dooku was a master of the second form of lightsaber combat, Makashi. This form was exclusively geared to lightsaber combat. Makashi emphasized proper footwork, extremely precise blade work, and careful controlled strikes over brute force and aggression. With Makashi, your goal was not to smash through your opponent's defenses like Form 5, but rather to slowly cut away at your opponent with deadly precision until finding your opening and striking them down. During the waning years of the Republic, Makashi became a rarely utilized form, as most opponents of the Jedi wielded blasters instead of swords or lightsabers. Thus, a user focusing primarily on Makashi would be at a distinct disadvantage when facing blaster-wielding foes. However, when faced with an opponent wielding a lightsaber, a master of Makashi would find themselves at a distinct advantage, as the form is a pure dueling form. The blade work of Makashi is based mainly off of fencing combat and utilizes more thrusts and precise footwork than any other lightsaber form. Makashi does have a major weakness, however, in that while the user conserves energy and holds the advantage in swordsmanship, Makashi lacks power behind its strikes and its defense. For example, Anakin was a practitioner of Form 5 Jemso, a form that relies on raw strength and power strikes. Because of this, in his final duel with Dooku, Anakin was able to smash away at Dooku's defenses and eventually overpower him. Still, if you live a life where you constantly find yourself in lightsaber duels, it's a safe bet that Makashi will get you far. Dooku was portrayed in Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith by veteran actor Christopher Lee, one of the greatest actors of all time. Sir Christopher Lee was actually offered a role in the original Star Wars, but declined the role, and the role went to his good friend Peter Cushing. When he was offered a role in the prequel trilogy, Christopher Lee decided not to pass up the opportunity again, and signed on to play Count Dooku. Christopher Lee holds the record for most on-screen sword fights, and was himself a master swordsman. Thus, he was ideal for the role of an aged blade master. Though because of Christopher Lee's age, many of his more impressive moments in his on-screen duels were performed by Kyle Rowling. With that said, Christopher Lee still performed quite a bit of his own blade work in these films. As with the previous film, the prop department created many new hilts from resin and other materials. However, Dooku's lightsaber was crafted specifically for the character, and its curved design might have been a nod to Christopher Lee's lineage, as Christopher Lee is a descendant of the Emperor Charlemagne, who himself was said to have wielded a saber with a curved handle, though this is up for debate. Once again, the prop blades used in Attack of the Clones were made from steel and aluminum-based rods that screwed into the handle of the saber. These blades were more durable than those used in the original trilogy, which were made of carbon fiber. However, they still bent and required constant replacement. However, during the filming of Revenge of the Sith, the prop blades were made from carbon fiber rods that were laminated with glass and plastic. This made the blades far more durable and completely resistant to warping and flexing. However, they were also extremely hard and would often cause bruising and even some scarring. Dooku's hero lightsaber, or the lightsaber used in close-up shots, was gifted to stunt coordinator Nick Gillard after filming of Revenge of the Sith, and was later auctioned off to a buyer for £50,000, or $62,209.95 USD. And before we move on, here is an interesting fact you may not know. Dooku was originally going to duel Yoda using both his lightsaber and the blue lightsaber previously wielded by Anakin and Obi-Wan. However, it was deemed too much or too difficult to choreograph, and they decided to settle on him just using the single blade. Granted, I think it worked out better in the end, but still, it's interesting to think about. Though I really didn't appreciate the design of Dooku's saber as a kid, as an adult, it's definitely in my top 10 favorite designs, maybe top 5. I just love how unique it is, and having dueled with a replica of Dooku's lightsaber in the past, I can definitely see the appeal of the curved hilt. It definitely feels more ergonomic and elegant when you're fighting with one, though I'd still take a standard hilt over a curved hilt. I also love the claw at the top of the emitter. It's subtle touches like that that really add a sinister vibe to what is otherwise a beautiful saber. It also helps that it has one of my favorite saber ignition scenes. And of course, having Christopher Lee's name attached to it is always a win. So, there you have it guys, Count Dooku's lightsaber. What did you guys think of this video? And what lightsaber would you like me to cover next? Be sure to give this video a like, comment below, and subscribe. Thank you for watching, we'll see you next time on Concordia Jedi. And remember, the Force will be with you. Always.